大家好 ，I'm Nathan Rich, aka 火锅大王。I'm back, and hopefully for the last time, we're gonna deal with Peter Zion. We've all sat through his magnificent display of ignorance for multiple videos. We've cringed through Peter's wild, rampant misunderstandings of even the most basic aspects of geopolitics. I dragged us through his magic triple 95% numbers when it came to vaccines, but that was nothing.We heard how a million Chinese soldiers would die traversing the Taiwan Strait, and countless other moronic things about China, but trust me, it was worth it. It was all worth it for this next part. Peter is going to tell us what would happen to China if the United States decided to sanction it. Here we go.
If you put the sanctions that we have put against Russia onto China, oh my. China's imports 85% of their energy?
Nope. China does not import 85% of its energy. Wrong. Not even close.
85% of that from the Persian Gulf?
Wrong again. Not even 85% of the crude oil imports alone are from the Middle East. You are really, really bad at this. Wow. You don't understand even the most basic facts about energy.
And they import 85% of the inputs that are necessary to grow their food.
85%, 85%, 85%. Another triplet of wrong numbers. I know I've broken up what he's lying about so many times, it's hard to keep track. So to remind you, he's telling us what will happen if the U.S. sanctions China. Go on.
You would have an industrial collapse, a civilizational breakdown, and mass famine within 6 months. And then you would probably lose a half a billion Chinese over the course of the next year to famine.
That's right, everyone. If the U.S. sanctioned China, 500 million people would die from famine nearly immediately. Now, just for your reference, that's somewhere in the ballpark of the total number of people who have died in all recorded famines everywhere in the world throughout all of history combined, everywhere forever. And that would happen in like a year and a half, if the U.S. sanctioned China. And just listen to how casually he just moves on to the next thing after his dramatic pause, of course.
Probably lose a half a billion Chinese over the course of the next year to famine. But I think the one that has scared the Chinese the most are the boycotts.
Wow, Peter, you are really opening my eyes to the truth. And thank God the U.S. military is hearing this truth too. The Chinese know that if America sanctions them, it would result in 500 million dead people. And also boycotts. To be clear, over a third of the country starving to death in a year. That's pretty bad. The rampant chaos, riots, and civil wars over food that would all erupt, not fun. The entire country collapsing into a decade-long, kill-or-be-killed, nightmarish hellscape of roaming, violent gangs of cannibals, that would be so annoying. But you know what's way more scary than that? Boycotts. And now Peter will share with us a fairy tale about a couple of mom-and-pop petrol shops just doing the right thing. The following is so ridiculously naive, I almost thought he was joking when I first heard it. But though he is a joke, this is not a joke.
BP and Halliburton didn't have to leave. They weren't doing anything that was sanctioned. But the super majors and the oil services firms and countless other firms left on a moral imperative prompted by individual shareholders and consumers. And in China, the idea that the average Joe or Jane can influence policy is so antithetical to their mindset that they had no idea this was even possible, much less it was going to happen.
Average Joe or Jane. This professional geopolitical analyst has just told us that BP and Halliburton voluntarily exiting Russia are policy somehow, and that they, out of the kindness of their hearts, took action against Russia. You know, because of individual shareholders. They've been through a lot with their massive jumps in profit. Oh, wow, what does that one say? Halliburton is forecast to reap the largest profit increase in more than 5 years. That's just a happy coincidence, according to your analysis, right? Coincidence. Man, that's a deep theory. And also, I like how you pretend that the Chinese have no idea that it's possible for foreign companies to suddenly abandon them. I really, really like this line from you because it really shines a bright light on just how ill-conceived your little pathetic analyses are. To demonstrate how stupid you are, let's simply take the opposite assumption and test to see what that would look like. Let's assume not that China is stupid and doesn't try to protect itself from foreign corporate abandonment, but instead that it is smart and does try to protect itself from that corporate abandonment. What would we expect to find as evidence of that, Peter? I mean, it would probably have a corporate system that prioritizes local companies' abilities to grow in certain industries. We would expect to see a system which emulates innovations from abroad, so China can develop its own products. Companies coming to China would probably need to create a local Chinese version of their company, so that they are subject to and protected by Chinese laws. That would help ensure the country is not totally overrun by foreign brands. But, I mean, we don't find those things in China, do we? Well, I mean, you tell me, Peter. Has China done literally everything you would expect from a country who's aware of this threat or not? Because you're saying that they haven't done these things. So, have they or haven't they? They have.
So, everything that the Chinese have based their system and their strategic policy on for the last 30 years has been proven in the last 2 months to be utterly wrong.
30 years? What 30 years? What are you talking about? And yes, it's been proven to be utterly wrong by you right now, or I. And here's the most interesting part psychologically. I like to think that somewhere in his mind, he knows just how dishonest he is, and he tries to tell us, the audience, why he makes all this stuff up. He says the next part as sort of an assertion, but as you listen to it, I want you to know this. I think this is actually a confession. He's telling us why he lies and why he spreads disinformation.
I see China with not just a demographic failure, but a failure of leadership, a failure of policy, an agricultural failure, and an energy failure all at the same time.
See what I mean? He's explaining his issue. He skimmed a bunch of news headlines and formed a deep-rooted opinion over the years. China's a failure in some unknown, unspecified way. His insecurity about the unknown fuels his drive to replace the unspecified with familiar values. He knows China's bad. He just needs to discover why it's bad. He knows China's already a failure. He just needs to figure out how and why it'll all come crashing down any minute now. This is a man not living in the future, as he claims, but in a Swiss cheese past, filled with gaps, much like his brain. He endlessly seeks to fill those gaps, and if he has to make up statistics and flat-out lie to the US military, he will do that. Insecurity about the unknown is a very powerful force. Anyway, after accidentally explaining why he does all this, because he starts everything with this anti-China view, he goes on to say this, followed, of course, with a long, dramatic pause.
It is entirely possible that this is the last year of the People's Republic. But I'm getting ahead of myself.
It seems like every single year that I've been in China, I've heard experts forecast China's demise, and every time they're wrong. It's really become a weird doomsday anti-China cult out there. And it's pretty dismissive of Chinese people if you really think about it. Like there's just nothing anyone can do about it in China. They're all just destined to fail, those losers. And yet, they never seem to actually fail. Weird, culty behavior. So then, one of the military personnel asks him to go back to the wages issue. Are you sure America's cheaper than China, Peter? So let's hear some of his lies in response to this very simple question.
Because the United States produces energy at home versus importing it from several thousand miles away, our energy costs are so much cheaper.
Wrong. That's a lie. And not only is it a lie, you went out of your way to emphasize it. Why? It's easily falsifiable. Is it just that you hate the military and you want them to look stupid for listening to you or something? Are you trying to get some dominance over others by deception or what is your deal, dude?
So like Mexican labor's half the cost and more highly skilled than Chinese labor, and that makes a big difference too.
Hey, US military, don't listen to me. Don't get any facts from me. You go search for the truth. Now, I know you're busy, so here's all you have to do. Just pick a few random things that he said that sound a little weird. After you research those few things, well, you see what I mean? All of it was BS. Then he changes the subject to global energy stuff, which is quite long, so skipping all that stuff. Then he drops this ridiculous bombshell with his trademarked "I just lied to you" pause.
over the next few years, we're probably going to lose 1 billion people from famine as globalization breaks down.
Damn you, Russia?
And the Russians have ensured that this starts in the fourth quarter of this year.
Then he starts cursing and losing his notes for some reason, and long story short, goes back to how China's already dead and gone.
Oh, shit. I forgot to say that from earlier. So I can't see my own notes. I can't remember where I put what slide. All right. These two things that popped up that I forgot about. The Chinese are going to have to suck up the entirety of the entire shortfall from the entire Ukraine war. We are talking a minimum of 5 million barrels a day that the Chinese just aren't going to have. So their overall ability to source crude is dropping by over a third. And there is no way you do that without an industrial stop. That's probably going to happen before the end of the year. We're that close.
The long dramatic pause. Oh my God. Is anyone buying this? China's going to shut down its entire industry because of the war in Ukraine. Like, literally in a few months. That's what this person, this expert, just told the US military. Then he explains why China wouldn't be able to use its navy to secure oil from the Middle East in the case of a global energy panic. The reason? Well, China's navy, while it may be huge, is basically just a bunch of toy boats floating around in the ocean.
The Chinese do have a navy. It is large. It does have a number of ships. But 90% of them cannot sail more than 1,000 miles from the coast. And even that assumes that they're moving slow to conserve speed. They're going in a straight line and no one is shooting at them.
Yep, it's just another stupid lie. He's building up an entire stupid argument based on lies here, so I'll just let him dig his hole a little deeper. Go on.
The Chinese utterly lack the capacity to put a navy in the Indian Ocean, regardless of clashes with Vietnam, Malaysia, Indonesia, or India. They just can't do it.
My God, this is shocking. Because, I mean, according to the entire world, China's already had warships in the Indian Ocean since at least 2008. But I mean, you've only had 14 years to discover that, Peter, so maybe that's a little rushed. It seemed like 14 years is enough time to type in China Navy Indian Ocean into a search engine, but I don't know, maybe I'm wrong. I guess you're right, China just can't do it for some reason. And finally, Peter tells the military the ultimate strategy. Forget Sun Tzu. Move over, man. Here comes the ultimate in war strategy masters. Here comes Sun Zayan.
So in any war scenario, someone's going to put a couple of destroyers in the Indian Ocean, maybe the Japanese, maybe us, and that is the end of the Chinese industrial experience completely, assuming that the lights just don't go out this year and never come back online.
The greatest victory is that which requires no battle. That's stupid. We have a new quote for future generations of strategists. Get out your Art of War books and write down this new one. Put a couple of destroyers in the Indian Ocean, and that will be the end of China. Because, you know, their navy can't get there. Let's just hope no one looks up anything Peter just lied about, because it doesn't go so well for those who do. They may be surprised to find that, in fact, Chinese destroyers can go more than 1,000 miles. These destroyers can go 5,000 nautical miles. I mean, 5,000 is still a higher number than 1,000, right? I'm just checking because I don't know, maybe 5,000 suddenly starved half to death from being sanctioned or something? You tell me. And you know what's crazy? You actually don't need to do very complicated comparisons like is 1,000 higher or lower than 5,000 to realize Chinese destroyers can reach the Indian Ocean. And that's because it's not just warships that have been to the Indian Ocean. Chinese destroyers have also been to the Indian Ocean. We don't need to speculate about it. It's already happened. I mean, did anyone in that military seminar notice any of this? Are they just being polite or what? Then he goes through almost word for word all the stuff from the other video that I covered. Then, because of the false premise he set up, he says the only way for China to get out of lockdowns is to change to different vaccines.
China is stuck with this policy until such time as it collapses or they bring in $3 trillion of someone else's vaccine, which is not going to happen.
That's right. China needs to revaccinate everyone by buying $3 trillion worth of vaccines. Of course, if they had $3 trillion to throw away, they could literally buy Moderna, Pfizer, BioNTech, every single vaccine from every company in every country in the entire world, and still have enough money left over to make billboard signs all across the world exposing what a fraud Peter is. But pretending that what you said made any sense at all, as we've already talked about, those vaccines wouldn't help less people die. I mean, the absolute sheer idiocy that it takes to stand in America and give China advice about how to handle COVID is just, wow. If there's one country in the entire world that absolutely cannot give advice to anyone about COVID, it's the United States. And a small part of that massive, embarrassing failure that our country has committed against its people is due to experts like you spreading unsubstantiated garbage rumors and random thoughts as facts.
So if you have an iPhone, I hope you like it. There's probably not going to be another one for several years.
How does anyone listen to this moron? It's so hard to continue. He's so stupid. Oh, God. Woo!
So one way or another, demographically, financially, politically, health, food, one way or another, we are living in China's final years right now. And it's not the sort of country that I really worry about being there in the long run.
Long pause. Drama. This guy's a drama queen, not a researcher. I can't keep going. Then he makes another point about how Japan has finally joined America's side and is with us completely. Here's his evidence. Now, if you're Asian, or if you've been to Asia or studied Asia or know how to spell Asia, you will probably react how I did.
And when it came time to put sanctions on the Russians for the Ukraine war, Japan, a country that was always tried to be neutral versus Russia, they were the third country to sign on. They're with us now.
Always tried to be neutral versus Russia. Imagine professing yourself an expert and then saying that Japan has always tried to be neutral against Russia. Oh, what a moron. Oh, God. That is hilariously wrong. Every day, every single day, I read about another conflict between Russia and Japan. And Japan isn't always the aggressor, but it really was a lot of the time. If you knew even a slight amount of history about Manchuria, railroads, Manchukuo, Korea, Siberia, Japan, Russia, any of it, you would never be able to say something so utterly stupid. Always tried to be neutral in Russia. So there you have it. Another doomsday-obsessed phony. And these military people pretty much got his message, I think. I don't know if they bought it, but this dude sums it up pretty well.
Yeah, it basically boiled down to the world is hosed, the geopolitical order is going to crash, and we are in for massive disruptions in both energy, and there's going to be massive wars and population collapse in the next couple of decades. Yep. So,
yeah, everything's all going to end except for America, who will be so far ahead of everyone else. We'll just fly with the eagles. China will be over in a couple of months here, you know, somehow. And if they survive, well, we can just send a couple of destroyers over to the Indian Ocean to completely wipe out their navy without any challenge. And if they try to go to Taiwan, all of human history's famines will suddenly happen at the same time in one place. And they'll have no protection because they dumped half their army into the ocean from fishing boats. In fact, no matter what anyone does, China basically just doesn't exist anymore. I mean, this is all clearly, obviously, way over the top disinformation. I don't know why the United States government is paying you to deliver it, but I really hope that they stop because it is endangering the United States. God help us if any of those people who watched that seminar actually believe you. For those of us located here in the main part of the world, Asia, we'll take pride in knowing that we're still here, and though challenges are never far apart, China's many thousands of years of history won't be affected by one masochist fantasies. He may seek pleasure by defeating his own discomfort about China, by denying its existence or promising people it's all going to go away soon. but China will make it through. And that's something we can all be proud of. A future in which we have to, sure, but also want to work with each other. You know, as if we're all humans and all deserve each other. To you out there in the sadly COVID-ridden US, sorry to say, the future here in China is looking quite bright. Until next time, I'm Nathan Rich. Please don't listen to idiots like this guy. Thanks, everybody. See you.
This is really bad.